the food you don't eat. I originally started with a survey of some peers and professors. All I did was pose 5 simple questions. What do you think food waste is? How much food loss does the US generate annually? What do you think are the leading causes of food loss? Do you think food waste impacts you? Do you think you waste more than the average American? Please take a second and answer these yourself. Good. Hopefully by the end of this video, your answer will be a little more nuanced. This is going to be the basic structure that my video follows. Defining food waste. There is a difference between food waste and food loss. According to the United States Department of Agriculture, the USDA, food waste occurs when an edible item goes unconsumed. This can be food discarded by retailers due to undesirable colors or blemishes, or it could be plate waste where the consumer tosses food away. Food loss represents the amount of edible food post-harvest that's available for human consumption but not consumed for any reason. This can be from cooking loss, natural shrinkage, including the things from food waste, as well as loss from mold, pests, or inadequate climate control. How much food do you think is wasted annually by the US? According to the USDA, about a third of all produced food in the US is lost. In 2010, the US produced 430 billion pounds of food. We lost 133 billion pounds of that. 43 billion pounds, or a third, was lost at the retail level, while the remaining 90 billion was lost at the consumer level. This is at an estimated loss of $161.6 billion. Of that $161.6 billion, meat, poultry, and fish accounted for $48 billion, vegetables accounted for $30 billion, and dairy accounted for $27 billion. Clearly, perishables account for a lot of the food wasted. To give you some scale of how much food is wasted, according to Salmonella Academy, a sphere containing all the ants in the world mushed together would measure about 1,377 feet or 420 meters across, weighing in at about 88 billion pounds. Using another diameter from real life to compare, the Empire State Building is 1,454 feet or about 440 meters high. Imagine a sphere with the diameter of the Empire State Building. We waste more food than either individual sphere can contain. That's insane. The leading causes of food loss. Economic. For the sake of time, I'll be aiming to simplify this video. A report published by the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations can help clarify. Here is a proposed model to explain food loss. It's expansive and dense, and it's a great general model applicable to economies across the globe, but I'm only going to be focusing on the topics relevant to the US. Income. It's no secret that America is capitalistic. People want money. More is usually better. Farmers, being hardworking Americans, share this ideal. Sadly, farming is not always a profitable enterprise. A variety of factors can play into whether a farm can generate enough money to cover planting costs and continue operations into the next year. Here are a few things that can create an uncertain future for farmers. Losses from weather, pests, and disease. Market prices being low when it's time to harvest their crops. Commercial quality standards limiting which fruit can be sold. Farmers may overproduce to cover losses from prior years. Imperfect information causes overplanning to meet non-existent demand. Non-economic causes of food loss. Culture. This one seems like a no-brainer, but it slipped my mind when I was first considering this. Culture can play a huge role in food loss because it influences one's ability to cook, to use diverse ingredients, to reuse leftovers, and to portion plan. Latinos in the US compared to non-Latinos waste 25% less food annually. These food habits could spawn from how we celebrate festivities. Another cultural factor are increasing plate sizes. The Ebbinghaus illusion shows us that if something is surrounded by larger items, the surrounded thing looks smaller. Food on larger plates can seem less than they are. Using smaller plates and bowls can help reduce food waste by preventing overtaking. Social aspect. Age, education, size, and job division can affect how each household wastes. Planning capacity plays a large role here. Larger families tend to waste less due to easier planning since supplies are consumed more quickly. Families more educated on the impacts of food waste and benefits of being more resourceful tend to waste less. A civic sense of whether one should care plays another role as well. If you feel guilty about food waste, you probably won't waste food. Policy and legislation. Aesthetic guidelines are a form of legislation that feeds into a lot of food waste. The USDA sets their own standards for food grading at a retail level, which reduces the amount of money farmers could make. So to maximize profit, farmers often let less aesthetically approved fruits just drop on the floor to compost.
It's a lot easier and cheaper just to basically throw it away.
Another huge problem is the lack of legislation for some things. Sell-by, use-by, and display-by dates are all arbitrary. They're essentially worthless. This is basically another way companies can sway you to buy more since you should toss away chips that are expired and get something fresh. According to the USDA, only baby formula follows guidelines defining if something is no longer safe for consumption. The dates indicate best flavor or quality and when to remove the item from display for all other stuff. private standards. Beyond USDA standards, we have our own standards. Growing up surrounded by perfect fruits and vegetables, I have an intrinsic distrust for aesthetically unappealing food. This is bad. I know if you were given the choice between a solid carrot and a wonky carrot to cook for a meal or just eat as a snack, you'd probably choose the solid carrot. I don't blame you. What do you think are the impacts of food loss? The production of wasted food costs 2.5% of all annual energy consumption in the US. It requires all the land and infrastructure invested towards farming it, 300 million barrels of oil, and 25% of the total freshwater consumed by agriculture in the US. In 2005, the US Geological Survey found that 31% of extracted freshwater in California was used for the irrigation of crops. California was extracting 20,000 to 46,000 million gallons a day, and 3/4 of that extracted water was used for irrigation of crops. Due to a lack of rain, Southern California requires twice as much supplemental water as the North. It takes 2 acre feet of supplemental water in Butte County in Northern California, while it takes 4 acre feet of supplemental water in Kern County in Southern California. Environmental. Agriculture produced about 596 million metric tons of greenhouse gases in 2016. Half of that was methane. In the US, livestock is counted under agriculture. It accounts for 1/3 of the greenhouse gases emitted through agriculture. Methane is anywhere from 28 to 36 times more effective than carbon dioxide at trapping heat. Beef cattle remain the largest contributor of methane emissions from enteric fermentation. That is, their digestive process, so their poop and their farts account for 71% of 2016's methane emissions. Emissions from dairy cattle in 2016 account for 25%, and the remaining emissions were from horses, sheep, swine, goats, American bison, mules, and donkeys. Why am I talking about livestock? Developing countries that are growing economies, and even developed countries that have growing economies, are demanding more livestock than ever. Exports for all meat are expected to rise in 2018 thanks to a variety of countries such as Japan, Mexico, Canada, China, the Philippines, and more. This just means increased meat production. LFG. Once the food is tossed away, it does even more damage to the environment. Landfill gas, LFG, is identified as its own form of gas. It is the natural byproduct of the decomposition of organic materials in landfills. In 2016, about 16.4% of methane produced by the US came from landfills. That makes it the third largest producer of methane in the US. LFG is created in 4 phases. A chain of aerobic and anaerobic bacteria work off each other, producing different gases. Eventually, the gas rates become stable, with the landfill having 45 to 60% methane, with most of the remaining being carbon dioxide, and there's a few other gases too. Gas production lasts stably for 20 years, but continues to be emitted for 50 plus years, depending on how much organic matter is in the waste. That means tossing organic matter away is literally adding fuel to the methane fire. How this relates back to us. In 2014, the US generated 516 billion pounds of trash. 14.9% of that, nearly 77 billion pounds, is foodstuff. That means on average, each American is generating 4.4 pounds of waste daily. That amounts to 0.67 pounds of food wasted daily. Considering the average person consumes about 4 pounds of food every day, you can imagine finishing your daily food intake and then tossing out 2 fresh apples. That's kind of insane. I mean, generally, we don't do that. The wasting of the 2 apples is a generalization of how much you waste overall. More often than not, you're probably throwing away an entire bag of apples that you forgot to eat rather than 2 every day. What can we do to fix these problems? I know a ton of what I describe sounds like it's on a level that an individual could never impact. You're a regular Joe who works, buys, and lives. How about I provide you with some tips that you can use to change your own habits? You can waste less food, and you can do it right off the bat, and it wouldn't disrupt your life. As a purchaser, you can buy less. Stop buying in bulk. 3 for the price of 2? Great! But would you actually eat all 3 and not get sick of the taste? How many bags of chips do you have stashed away because they were all on sale or bought in bulk, but you no longer want to eat it? According to the National Resource Defense Council, the average American tosses out 1/4 of the food and beverages they buy. So when buying a week's worth of groceries, take out 1/4 of the items. If you need more, you can always get more. We're not in a time of famine or war. There's no need to hoard. Try to keep a routine of consumption. This should provide you with a schedule of how much you consume and when you do so. Proactively keep a list of ingredients you use so you don't shop by memory and emotion. If you go shopping while hungry, you're prone to overbuying. If you know what you want, you go in, you get out, and you save money and time. Check your refrigerator and cupboards before shopping. It's really easy to double buy, and once you do, you're probably going to eat the fresher food. This may not be a serious problem for storable items like chips, but for perishables like produce and meat, this could pose a huge problem. Understand your infrastructure. Learn how to use your refrigerator better. Most have specific containers for fruit and vegetables. When preparing fruits for later consumption, portion it as less than you normally would eat. Don't wash everything at once. Berries, for example, to prevent mold from growing, should be washed right before you eat it in the quantity you're gonna eat. Remember that expiration dates generally mean diddly squat in the US. YouTube provides so many resources. You suck at cooking, binging with Babish, Brothers Green. They all can teach you how to be frugal and expand your skills so you can incorporate older foods in with newer ones. Regarding leftovers, you can organize a concept similar to the food cam, which focuses on not wasting leftover food. Professor Lieberman from the Berkeley Law School told me that a similar phenomenon occurred at the law school, where there may be a poster in the lobby that identifies that there's leftovers from an event, so anyone with their own container can come and get some to go. On a tangent, I'm going to discuss some of the things from the study that I found applicable to Crossroads Dining Hall at my school, UC Berkeley. Crossroads, or Croads, serves pre-portioned food in a buffet style. You take as much as you want, but pre-portioned on oval plates. Each serving is supposed to be the recommended amount per meal for whatever food item that you're given. There are multiple stations you can get food at. Generally, you're not allowed to stack food on the same plate from station to station. I don't know why they have this policy. This induces people to gather a bunch of plates and take too much. This is usually a large problem at the start of the year when freshmen and junior transfers are trying to get used to things because they're not used to the portion of the food. The Berkeley Dining Sustainability Team gathered the trash that the students tossed on October 2nd of 2017 and gathered 244 pounds of edible food in the day. That's crazy. On a personal level, be more conscious about how much food you take. Start taking one or two plates at a time instead of gathering four or five. Use the takeout box because you can spend more time eating and waste less. You might not feel as hungry after eating half the food you took, but if it's in the to-go box, you can have a snack for later. The impacts of food waste are real. On a personal scale, it may seem negligible. Having so much of something for so long makes you forget how much you have. The stories of foreigners you hear moving to America and marveling at the American supermarkets is real. Don't take your privilege for granted. Next time you get sick of that apple, put it in a container and eat it later. It may have browned a bit, but it's still completely edible. There are countless ways for us to waste less in our lives. If we can reduce wasting two apples to one, we will have made a huge positive impact on the world. I hope this video has given you a better sense of the impact of our food waste. To make a change that your children and their children and every generation after will thank you for, all you have to do is be slightly more conscious about the food you don't eat.